Worship, turn our hearts and our minds toward our gratefulness to the Father for all that He has done in our lives. Kindness is everlasting. His mercy endures to all generations. Give thanks to the Lord, for He is good.
Thank you. be seated. Well, we're glad to see you tonight. We're a small group, but this is the first Thanksgiving Eve service we've had in 2 years. We have many people out of town, but we're glad that you came today to be a part of this. Let's pray together. Father, we are indeed grateful for how much you love us, for all that you've done for us. Lord, these have been difficult days. Many lives, Lord, have been challenged this year. And Lord, we thank you for your constant presence, because you've never abandoned, you never leave us, you never forsake us. Even in those moments when we thought we were alone, we were not. And so, Lord, thank you for the kind of love that you have for us. This evening, Lord, as we celebrate Thanksgiving, Lord, may we be reminded that we have most to be thankful for because of you. And so, Lord, may you be honored this evening. And this is our prayer in Jesus' name.
Thank you. If you walk out of here tonight without thanksgiving in your heart, after the music we've just heard, and I'm talking about the offertory, that's what it was, by the way, and Karen Solo, I will tell you, you're deaf. You're just plain deaf. Whew. So, Pastor Stan asked us to talk about something that has been a blessing during this last several months. It's been a very difficult time. And I want to talk about the blessing that I've experienced. But before I do that, I need to lay some groundwork for you to understand what my blessing is. First of all, I want to tell you what kind of a person I am. Some of you think you already know, and some of you, I'm sure, do. I'm a very shy person. I'm an introvert. I have always been willing to go sit in a corner at a party and watch everybody else, and I could enjoy myself doing that. They used to call people like me a wallflower. It's very hard for me to meet strangers. And I'm only really comfortable when I'm in a defined role. I can teach because being a teacher is a very carefully defined role, and I'm comfortable in that. I'm comfortable in the pulpit because it's a defined role. But put me out in the vestibule, and I'm lost. I don't speak unless I'm spoken to. And when I'm totally focused on something, I can walk by everybody in the world and never even know they exist. Someday, if you ask me, I'll tell you a story about a secretary I had who chewed me out royally because I didn't say good morning. And I didn't. Now, you need to understand that when I was a child, I was told something repeatedly. Children are seen and not heard. And I grew up in a pastor's home, and I was expected to set a perfect example of a perfect little boy. If you know anything at all about me, you will know that me trying to be a perfect little boy didn't work. But I got punished for that, and every time I would speak out, I got punished. And after a while, you learn, don't talk. So I don't. So, that's me. Now, the Bible gives us a foundation for the blessing that I'm going to share with you. The first place I'd like you to think about is a passage that's in Romans, the 12th chapter and the 10th verse. And Paul said, "Be kindly affectioned one to another with brotherly love in honor, preferring one another." I want you to know that showing love to each other is not an option. The way he worded that is a command. And he really should have said, now you be kindly affectioned, which means it's an order. So we're supposed to show love one to another. And it's something that God taught us to do. In 1 Thessalonians, the 4th chapter and the 9th verse, Paul said, "But as touching brotherly love, ye need not that I write unto you. For ye yourselves are taught of God to love one another." He taught us to love one another. And you know how he did that? He did it by example. He gave us the example of the greatest kind of love that man could ever see. And that was when he sent his son to die for us. In John 3:16, it said, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son." It was love that drew that. And that example of love is the one on which he bases his expectations of us. And we're to work to preserve the love that we share because we have been born again. In Hebrews, the 13th chapter and the 11th verse, it says, "Let brotherly love continue." In other words, you've experienced love. Now, let it continue and let it show in and through you. Now, we've been put in a place where we can find love and experience it firsthand. And the Holy Spirit works within us to help us grow in our love for each other. Those commandments are for the believers. He said, love one another as you've been taught. We're supposed to love each other. And he says, don't stop loving each other. Now, there are times among us when we get at cross purposes and we think, well, I can't stand that person. That's not what the Bible says. The Bible says, love one another anyway. That's hard, isn't it? And Paul is very, very careful in telling us that we ought to work together to provide, to preserve the unity of the church. And the way you do that is by loving one another. So, that's the biblical foundation for the blessing that I have. We're supposed to love one another. Okay? So what's that mean to me? Well, I look around and I see other people in the congregation who are examples of loving people. They love each other. And I'm not talking about husbands and wives. Sometimes you look at husbands and wives and you don't see that they love each other. You should, but you don't always see it that way. But I'm talking about other folks in the congregation who seem to love everybody. They're just open and loving and caring. And I see them as being obedient to the Scripture's teaching. And I see that obedience when I feel their love, when I sense that they love me. And I know that they're being obedient to Scripture. And sometimes when I see that, I feel my own love for people growing as we meet and serve together. And that's obedience on my part. Now, there's a word that describes what I'm talking about, and the word is fellowship. That's my blessing. It's what I feel in this congregation. What's contained in the word fellowship is important. And we've learned some things during the pandemic, and the relationships between many of us have grown much stronger during the pandemic than they were before. We've done some things to help that occur. We had a neat thing that we did several months ago. We did bag lunches. That was a fun evening. We got together, everybody brought their own bag lunch. Nobody shared anything except conversation and fun at the table. Great evening. We met in classes. When we meet together in class and in services, it's a part of the fellowship that we share together. And even though we kept our distance and we sat apart from each other, I was glad that I was married to Linda because I could sit close to her. Other than that, I would have had to sit 6 feet apart. But, you know, we kept our social distance. And we bumped fists. That's a new way of shaking hands. We're back to careful hugs now. There are some people who are willing to hug me, and I'm willing to hug some other people. That's good. I like that. And we smiled under our masks when we saw each other. Do you know that you can see a person smile by looking at their eyes? You really can. And so we stayed in touch with each other, and we showed each other that we care. And we did that because we prayed for each other, and we prayed with each other. And the prayer chain did a lot to help us to hold together as a fellowship. And even though these last 18 months have been very difficult for many of us, the fellowship that I've experienced in this church is an act of love and sharing by others. I'm thankful for the blessing of the Lord in my life, through the people who have helped me to overcome some of the limitations that were mine because of my upbringing and the way my personality works. So I've experienced the fellowship of the people of this church who share with me and share with others. And that's one of the things that makes this church such a wonderful place to be. My blessing is fellowship. And I thank the Lord and thank each and every one of you who has worked to make this a real family that loves and cares for each other.
Unlike Charles, I am not a wallflower. I'm not an introvert. And I like going into the lobby, sharing and talking. But we're all different, right? And it takes all of us to make a body of believers. Well, I was asked to share a little bit something, too. And, you know, we've all experienced the pandemic. We've experienced a year and a half of loss. We've experienced a lot of bad things that come as a result of the pandemic. And it would be easy for each of us to focus and miss all of the blessings in disguise. We usually have a tendency to look at what was taken from us, what we don't have, or what is missing in our lives. But when we allow ourselves, when we choose to allow ourselves to focus on the blessing, even in the failures, even in the suffering, even in the hardships, we'll benefit from it. Even amid all of the loss, we still have plenty to be grateful for. We have an ever-faithful God to attach our hope to. I want to share a few ways that I've seen God's presence amid the pressures of the pandemic. I've seen God's presence in the stillness. Maybe you remember how things were a year and a half ago when there were no sports on TV. There were no new shows being produced. Many of us were home watching Netflix, binging on Netflix shows. There was family time. There was talking going on. There was stillness. There was no distractions and diversions, and it gave us all an opportunity to recalibrate our focus and get our priorities straight. In those time of stillness, we were able to focus on hearing from God more clearly. We needed, and we stopped, and we were seeing ways in which God was working. Psalm 46:10 says, "Be still and know that I am God." When was the last time you were still before the Lord and you recognized that He is the Lord of our lives? I've seen God's presence among the way that we are able to rely upon Him in many ways, personally, financially. He has met our needs socially, emotionally. I've seen marriages strengthened because of this time in this past year. Many lives were impacted, some for the good and some for the bad. But I want to share that we all have a choice. With any hardship we face, we can either run to God or we can run from God. When we run to God, I want you to know that when we run to God, he doesn't run from us. He doesn't play keep away or tag. He meets us on the way. He runs to us like the good father did in the story of the prodigal. So we should run to God regardless of our circumstances. Sometimes it's not easy, but that's what faith is. We have learned to spend more time in prayer and how important that is, relying upon God for strength through these times. We've experienced God's faithfulness. God has showed up in a big way this year. I'm sure not only in my life, but in your lives as well. He has provided all that we need and many of our wants as well. There is no greater God than our God, and He always comes through on His promises. God is faithful. God is faithful. I've seen relationships strengthened. I've gained a deeper affection and an appreciation for family and friends. The importance of those relationships have been intensified because of the isolation that we've all experienced. And I hope that all of you have a greater appreciation for relationships and how important it is to maintain those relationships. Never have I been more grateful for those who I love and those who love me. Sometimes it's difficult, I have to admit, loving me, because I'm not an easy person to love. I've been able to spend more time with my wife over these past year and a half, walking and talking and dreaming and planning, and for that I'm grateful. Our marriage is stronger because of it.
we always have a choice when we face fire. We can either run from it or run or grow from it. And we have a choice. We should let it refine us because it's important that we grow from it. But the greatest blessing I received from the Lord this year, amid all of the difficulties, I would have to say is God's provision, His goodness toward me. God is a good, good Father. He has met all of our needs. He has given us many of our wants. He has demonstrated His generosity through this church family, through people. We have a situation where we're renting a home. Many of you know we're building a house. We're renting a home, and our landlord, Lord, he could have said, you know, that your time is up, your lease is expired, go find the new place to live. But He has been gracious to us and has given us an extension of time. God uses His people to demonstrate His goodness, God's goodness, and His generosity toward us. I'm grateful for you, my church family, for your generosity, for your encouragement. I'm grateful for God has blessed me with special friends who show up in those hard times when there's trusses that need to be put on the roof and other things. I'm grateful for a new neighbor that I have. I have a neighbor who's come out and has helped us out on the construction site. A man that doesn't even know us, but because he's just a good neighbor, he wants to be there to help. So I'm grateful for all of those things. The psalmist writes in the 121st Psalms, he writes, I will lift my eyes to the hills. From whence comes my help? My help comes from the Lord who made heaven and earth. He will not allow your foot to be moved. He who keeps you will not slumber. Behold, he who keeps Israel shall neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord is your keeper. The Lord is your shade at your right hand. The sun shall not strike you by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord shall preserve you from all evil. He shall preserve your soul. The Lord shall preserve you going out and you coming in from this time forth and forevermore. So we need to, we're reminded that we need to lift our eyes to the Lord. He is our keeper. He has everything under control. He is our protector. He gives us guidance. He gives us blessing. Every blessing we have comes from the Lord. He is the maker of heaven and earth, and He is a watchful keeper. He knows exactly what you're going through. He knows exactly what you need, and He is our guardian, and He's the one that we run to for protection, both during the day and in the night. So those are some of the things that I am grateful for this year. I am truly blessed, and I'm grateful to be a part of this church.
Well, I'm last, and maybe least. I'm not sure. When we think about this year, there have been a lot of difficulties. When we started this year, I had no idea that my oldest son would be in heaven tonight. I had no idea that there would be as many deaths as we've had in our church. But I discovered something through all of this, that God never, ever abandons His own. He's always here for us. And so while we have all been faced with difficulties, some are still being faced with difficulties. John is facing some surgeries coming up after Thanksgiving, and there are others who are dealing with various and sundry things. But we find our hope and our comfort from God's Word. I want to share just a portion of three psalms with you tonight. First one is found in Psalm 28. The writer of this psalm says in verse 7, "The Lord is my strength and my shield." We need to understand that along with the strength that the Lord gives us, He also shields us. He puts a protection up around us, and for that, I am thankful. He goes on to say, "My heart trusted in Him, and I am helped." Do you know that when you call on the Lord that he does help. He does come to our aid when we ask him to. When we are indeed communicative with him, he communicates with us. The Bible says that if we'll draw near to him, he draws near to us. And so he is indeed our helper. Therefore, because of that, my heart greatly rejoices. Because of what? Because of his strength, because of his shield, because of his help. Our hearts should greatly rejoice. And with my song will I praise him. Well, whether you sing or not, we need to praise him for his faithfulness to us, for all that he does for us. He always keeps a promise. He never breaks a promise. And these are promises here. He says, I'll be your strength. I'll be your shield. I'll be your help. And indeed he is. And then over in Psalm 89, we find these verses. And the heavens shall praise thy wonders. Do you ever see the wonders of the Lord? When he talks about the heavens praising his wonders, he's talking about not only the heavens there, but he's talking about the heavens that we see. Do you know that I believe that every time the stars come out, they're praising their creator? Listen, Jesus said, if we will not praise him, he will have the rocks cry out and praise him. So that which he has created, I believe, praises our Lord. And so the heavens shall praise thy wonders. O Lord, thy faithfulness also in the congregation of the saints. Do you know that everybody in this church fellowship has experienced the faithfulness of the Lord? If you have not picked up one of these, make sure you do that before you go. We had asked folks to write down blessings that they have received this year. Many responded, and you need to read these. These are the ways that God has blessed the congregation, even in the face of a lot of difficulties, even in the face of pandemic, even in the face of getting over the death of loved ones. God's faithfulness and blessings have been great among us. And so he goes on to say, for who in the heavens can be compared unto the Lord? Who among the sons of the mighty can be likened unto the Lord? God is greatly to be feared or revered in the assembly of the saints and to be had in reverence of all those who are about him. God blesses his congregation. Have you been blessed this year? He blesses us, and we are indeed grateful. And then finally, in the 105th Psalm, we find these words in the very first two verses. He says, oh, give thanks unto the Lord. Call upon his name. Make known his deeds among the peoples. Do you know that's what these two men have just done? They've made known to you the deeds of the Lord in their lives. And do you know that every time we stand and give testimony, every time we share with one another what God has done, we are blessing the Lord and we're giving credit to him for the deeds that he has done among us. And then he says, sing unto him, sing psalms unto him, talk ye of all his wondrous works. I've been a Baptist a long time. Baptists like to talk. You know, I hear that during prelude time every Sunday morning. Sometimes folks just chatter, 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 chatter. And that's fine. You know, there needs to come a time when we zip it and get our hearts ready for worship. However, it is wonderful to share with one another the blessings of the Lord. It is good to share what God's doing in our lives, because that becomes an encouragement to each other. And how can we better build up the family of God than sharing with one another what God's doing? You know, we need to be interested in one another, what God is doing in each other's lives. We need to bear witness of Him. And listen, the world needs to know that God is real. And how will they know that He's real unless they hear it from God's people? They need to hear the testimonies of our heart, what God is doing. Well, if I had to write an epitaph of this year, and I was not a Christian, I'd say this has been the most horrible year. If I had to write an epitaph of this year, if I were not a Christian, I would say it's been bad. I don't want to ever see this kind of year again. But because I am a Christian, because I'm a believer, because I'm a follower of Christ, I can say that in all of the difficulties of this year, God has been found faithful. He is not abandoned, and He has blessed. And He continues to do that. You know, if you can just kind of envision for a moment that God wraps His wonderful big arms around us now. We're putting a body to God. God's a spirit. He must be worshiped in spirit and in truth. However, He does give us hugs. You know, He works through the Holy Spirit. And if you can just kind of see that God often wraps His arms around us, draws us close, and brings a love to us that we can't find anywhere else, that brings a comfort to us that can't be found anywhere else. I think we could say this evening that God is good. God is great. He is. And we've all experienced His goodness and His greatness this year, even when the storm was hurling really fierce. God's been there. That's my blessing. I believe that it's yours as well. Father, thank You for blessing us. Thank You, Lord, even in dark times, You've not abandoned us. Thank You, Lord, that in these times You have shown up and You have blessed, You have poured out Your love and Your healing and Your grace sufficient for every day. And Lord, for those things, we must give You thanks and praise. Tomorrow, when many will gather around a table with loved ones, some will be alone. But Lord, may we truly just be grateful for You. Lord, tomorrow of the calendar is a day of feasting. But Lord, in our hearts, it needs to be truly a day of thanksgiving and then thanks living because of Your presence. Lord, thank You for these people. Thank You, Lord, for this church family. Thank You for those, Lord, who are away from us. Lord, who are traveling. We ask that You'll give them protection while they're away. Bring them safely home to us. And Lord, as we look shortly to the end of this year and the beginning of another, may we remember that You have been with us through this one. And Lord, if You give us another year, You will be there as well. And so we give You praise and thanks. And we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.